Happy Wednesday. Today we are going to start our first longer whole class text we're going to read. It is called The Medicine Bag. Again, our essential question is, what are some milestones on the path to growing up? The path to growing up is lined with milestones. Some are universal, but others are meaningful only to you. Often you don't recognize them as milestones until later, after you've passed them. As you read, you will work with your whole class to explore a wide range of milestones on the path to growing up. Once you are logged into your textbook, you'll click on that whole class learning section, and it will take you to this option. We're going to click on the medicine bag. And as you are listening, if you also want to have your textbook pulled up and reading along with it, that would be wonderful. Here we go.
The Medicine Bag by Virginia Driving Hawks Navy. Short story. Background. The Lakota Indians are part of the Sioux Nation, an indigenous people of the Great Plains region of North America. Today, there are about 170,000 Sioux Indians living in the United States. About one-fifth of the American Indian population live on reservations, which are designated pieces of land ruled by tribal law. About the author. Virginia Driving Hawks Navy, born 1933, grew up on the Rosebud Reservation in South Dakota. Her grandmothers were storytellers, sharing traditional Sioux legends and folk tales that became an inspiration for Snavy's work. She realized that American Indians were often misrepresented in children's books, and she has worked throughout her writing career to portray American Indians realistically. In 2000, President Bill Clinton awarded Snavy a National Humanities Medal. The Medicine Bag by Virginia Driving Hawks Navy. Grandpa wasn't tall and stately like TV Indians. His hair wasn't in braids. It hung in stringy gray strands on his neck, and he was old. He was my great-grandfather, and he didn't live in a teepee. He lived all by himself in a part log, part tar paper shack on the Rosebud Reservation in South Dakota. My kid sister Cheryl and I always bragged about our Lakota grandpa, John Iron Shell. Our friends, who had always lived in the city and only knew about Indians from movies and TV, were impressed by our stories. Maybe we exaggerated and made Grandpa and the reservation sound glamorous, but when we returned home to Iowa after our yearly summer visit to Grandpa, we always had some exciting tale to tell. We usually had some authentic Lakota article to show our listeners. One year, Cheryl had new moccasins that Grandpa had made. On another visit, he gave me a small, round, flat rawhide drum decorated with a painting of a warrior riding a horse. He taught me a Lakota chant to sing while I beat the drum with a leather-covered stick that had a feather on the end. Man, that really made an impression. We never showed our friends Grandpa's picture. Not that we were ashamed of him, but because we knew that the glamorous tales we told didn't go with the real thing. Our friends would have laughed, so when Grandpa came to visit, I was so ashamed and embarrassed, I could have died. There are a lot of yippie poodles and other fancy little dogs in our neighborhood, but they usually barked singly at the mailman for the safety of their own yards. Now it sounded as if a whole pack of mutts were barking together in one place. I walked to the curb to see what the About a block away, I saw a crowd of little kids yelling, with the dogs yipping and growling around someone who was walking down the middle of the street. I watched the group as it slowly came closer and saw that in the center of the strange procession was a man wearing a tall black hat. He paused now and then to peer at something in his hand and at the houses on either side of the street. I felt cold and hot at the same time. I recognized the man. "Oh, no," I whispered. "It's Grandpa." I stood on the curb, unable to move, even though I wanted to run and hide. Then I got mad when I saw how the yippie dogs were growling and nipping at the old man's baggy pant legs, and how wearily he poked them away with his cane. "Stupid mutts," I said as I ran to rescue Grandpa. When I kicked and hollered at the dogs to get away, they put their tails between their legs and scattered. The kids ran to the curb where they watched me and the old man. "Grandpa," I said, and reached for his beat-up old tin suitcase tied shut with a rope. But he set it down right in the street and shook my hand. "How, Takoza, grandchild," he greeted me formally in Lakota. All I could do was stand there with the whole neighborhood watching and shake the hand of the leather-brown old man. I saw how gray his hair straggled from under his big black hat, which had a drooping feather in its crown. His rumpled black suit hung like a sack over his stooped frame. As he shook my hand, his coat fell open to expose a bright red satin shirt with a beaded bolo tie under the collar. His getup wasn't out of place on the reservation, but it sure was here, and I wanted to sink right through the pavement. "Hi," I muttered with my head down. I tried to pull my hand away when I felt his bony hand trembling and then looked up to see fatigue in his face. It felt like crying. I couldn't think of anything to say, so I picked up Grandpa's suitcase, took his arm, and guided him up the driveway to our house. Mom was standing on the steps. I don't know how long she'd been watching, but her hand was over her mouth, and she looked as if she couldn't believe what she saw. Then she ran to us. "Grandpa," she gasped, "how in the world did you get here?" She checked her move to embrace Grandpa, and I remembered that such a display of affection is unseemly to the Lakota and would have embarrassed him. "How, Marie?" he said as he shook Mom's hand. She smiled and took his other arm. As we supported him up the steps, the door banged open and Cheryl came bursting out of the house. She was all smiles and was so obviously glad to see Grandpa that I was ashamed of how I felt. "Grandpa," she yelled happily, "you came to see us!" Grandpa smiled, and Mom and I let go of him as he stretched out his arms to my 10-year-old sister, who was still young enough to be hugged. "Win chinchilla, little girl," he greeted her and then collapsed. He had fainted. Mom and I carried him into her sewing room, where we had a spare bed. After we had Grandpa on the bed, Mom stood there patting his shoulder. "You make Grandpa comfortable, Martin," she decided, "while I call the doctor." I reluctantly moved to the bed. I knew Grandpa wouldn't want to have Mom undress him, but I didn't want to either. He was so skinny and frail that his coat slipped off easily. When I loosened his tie and opened his shin collar, I felt a small leather pouch that hung from a thong around his neck. I left it alone and moved to remove his boots. The scuffed old cowboy boots were right, and he moaned as I put pressure on his legs to jerk them off. I put the boots on the floor and saw why they fit so tight. Each one was stuffed with money. I looked at the bills that lined the boots and started to ask about them, but Grandpa's eyes were closed again. Mom came back with a basin of water. "The doctor thinks Grandpa may be suffering from heat exhaustion," she explained as she bathed Grandpa's face. Mom gave a big sigh. "Oh, and Martin, how do you suppose he got here?" We found out after the doctor's visit. Grandpa was angrily sitting up in bed while Mom tried to feed him some soup. "Tonight, you let Marie feed you, Grandpa," said my dad, who had gotten home from work. "You're not really sick," he said as he gently pushed Grandpa back against the pillows. "The doctors think you just got too tired and hot after your long trip." Grandpa relaxed, and between sips of soup, he told us of his journey. Soon after we visited him, Grandpa decided that he would like to see where his only living descendants lived and what her home was like. Besides, he admitted sheepishly, he was lonesome after we left. I knew that everybody felt as guilty as I did, especially Mom. Mom was all Grandpa had left, so even after she married my dad, who's not an Indian, and after Cheryl and I were born, Mom made sure that every summer we spent a week with Grandpa. I never thought that Grandpa would be lonely after our visits, and none of us noticed how old and weak he had become. But Grandpa knew, so he came to us. He had ridden on buses for 2.5 days. When he arrived in the city, tired and stiff from sitting for so long, he set out walking to find us. He'd stopped to rest on the steps of some building downtown, and a policeman found him. The officer took Grandpa to the city bus stop, waited until the bus came, and then told the driver to let Grandpa out at Bellevue Drive. After Grandpa got off the bus, he started walking again, but he couldn't see the house numbers on the other side when he walked on the sidewalk, so he walked in the middle of the street. That's when all the little kids and dogs followed him. I knew everybody felt as bad as I did, yet I was so proud of this 86-year-old man who had never been away from the reservation, but who had the courage to travel so far alone. "You found the money in my boots?" he asked Mom. "Martin did," she answered, and then scolded. "Grandpa, you shouldn't have carried so much money. What if someone had stolen it from you?" Grandpa laughed. "I would have known if anyone tried to take the boots off my feet. The money is what I've saved for a long time, $100, for my funeral. But you take it now to buy groceries so that I won't be a burden to you while I'm here. That won't be necessary, Grandpa, Dad said. We are honored to have you with us, and you will never be a burden. I'm only sorry that we never thought to bring you home with us this summer and spare you the discomfort of a long bus trip. Grandpa was pleased. Thank you, he answered. But don't feel bad that you didn't bring me with you, for I would not have come then. It was not time. He said this in such a way that no one could argue with him. To Grandpa and the Lakota, he once told me, a thing would be done when it was the right time to do it, and that's the way it was. Also, Grandpa went on, looking at me, I have come because it is soon time for Martin to have the medicine bag. We all knew what that meant. Grandpa thought he was going to die, and he had to follow the tradition of his family to pass the medicine bag, along with its history, to the oldest male child. Even though the boy, he said, still looking at me, doesn't have an Indian name, the medicine bag will be his. I didn't know what to say. I had the same hot and cold feeling that I had when I first saw Grandpa in the street. The medicine bag was the dirty leather pouch I had found around his neck. I could never wear it, I almost said aloud. I thought of having my friends see it in gym class or at the swimming pool and could imagine the smart things they would say. But I just swallowed hard and took a step toward the bed. I knew I would have to take it. But Grandpa was tired. Not now, Martin, he said, waving his hand in dismissal. It is not time. Now I will sleep. So that's how Grandpa came to be with us for 2 months. My friends kept asking to come see the old man, but I put them off. I told myself that I didn't want them laughing at Grandpa. But even as I made excuses, I knew it wasn't Grandpa I was afraid they'd laugh at. Nothing bothered Cheryl about bringing her friends to see Grandpa. Every day after school started, there'd be a crew of giggling little girls or round-eyed little boys crowded around the old man on the porch, where he'd gotten in the habit of sitting every afternoon. Grandpa smiled in his gentle way and patiently answered their questions. Or he'd tell them stories of brave warriors, ghosts, and animals, and the kids listened in awed silence. Those little guys, thought Grandpa, was great. Finally, one day after school, my friends came home with me because nothing I said stopped them. We're going to see the great Indian of Bellevue Drive, said Hank, who was supposed to be my best friend. My brother has seen him 3 times, so he ought to be well enough to see us. When we got to my house, Grandpa was sitting on the porch. He had on his red shirt, but today he also wore a fringed leather vest trimmed with beads. Instead of his usual cowboy boots, he had solidly beaded moccasins on his feet. Of course, he had his old black hat on. He was seldom without it. But it had been brushed, and the feather in the beaded headband was proudly erect, its tip a bright white. His hair lay in silver strands over the red shirt collar. I stared, just as my friends did, and I heard one of them murmur, "Wow." Grandpa looked up, and when his eyes met mine, they twinkled as if he were laughing inside. He nodded to me, and my face got all hot. I could tell that he had known all along I was afraid he'd embarrass me in front of my friends. "How, Hoxilus, boys," he greeted and held out his hand. My buddies passed in single file and shook his hand as I introduced them. They were so polite, I almost laughed. "How, Grandpa," and even a, "How do you do, sir?" "You look fine, Grandpa," I said as the guy sat down. "Han, yes," he agreed. When I woke up this morning, it seemed the right time to dress in the good clothes. I knew that my grandson would be bringing his friends. "You guys want a soda or?" I offered, but no one answered. They were listening to Grandpa as he told how he'd killed the deer from which his vest was made. Grandpa did most of the talking. I was proud of him and amazed at how respectfully quiet my friends were. Mom had to chase them home at supper time. As they left, they shook Grandpa's hand again and said to me, "Can we come back?" But after they left, Mom said, "No more visitors for a while, Martin. Grandpa won't admit it, but his strength hasn't returned. He likes having company, but it tires him." That evening, Grandpa called me to his room before we went to sleep. "Tomorrow," he said, "when you come home, it will be time to give you the medicine bag." I felt a hard squeeze from where my heart is supposed to be and was scared, but I answered, "Okay, Grandpa, All night, I had weird dreams about thunder and lightning on a high hill. From a distance, I heard the slow beat of a drum. When I woke up in the morning, I felt as if I hadn't slept at all. At school, it seemed as if the day would never end, and when it finally did, I ran home. Grandpa was in his room, sitting on the bed. The shades were down, and the place was dim and cool. I sat on the floor in front of Grandpa, but he didn't even look at me. After what seemed a long time, he spoke. I sent your mother and sister away. What you will hear today is only for your ears. What you will receive is only for your hands. He fell silent. I felt shivers down my back. My father, in his early manhood, Grandpa began, made a vision quest to find a spirit guide for his life. You cannot understand how it was in that time, when the great Teton Lakota were first made to stay on the reservation. There was a strong need for guidance from Wakantanka, the Great Spirit. But too many of the young men were filled with despair and hatred. They thought it was hopeless to search for a vision when the glorious life was gone and only the hated confines of a reservation lay ahead. But my father held to the old ways. He carefully prepared for his quest with a purifying sweat bath, and then he went alone to a high butte top to fast and pray. After 3 days, he received his sacred dream, in which he found, after long searching, the white man's iron. He did not understand his vision of finding something belonging to the white people, for in that time, they were the enemy. When he came down from the butte to cleanse himself at the stream below, he found the remains of a campfire and broken shell of an iron kettle. This was a sign that reinforced his dream. He took a piece of the iron for his medicine bag, which he had made of elk skin years before, to prepare for his quest. He returned to his village where he told his dream to the wise old men of the tribe. They gave him the name Iron Shell, but they did not understand the meaning of the dream either. At first, Iron Shell kept the piece of iron with him at all times and believed it gave him protection from the evils of those unhappy days. Then a terrible thing happened to Iron Shell. He and several other young men were taken from their homes by the soldiers and sent to a boarding school far from home. He was angry and lonesome for his parents and for the young girl he had wed before he was taken away. At first, Iron Shell resisted the teacher's attempts to change him, and he did not try to learn. One day, it was his turn to work in the school's blacksmith shop. As he walked into the place, he knew that his medicine had brought him there to learn and work with the white man's iron. Iron Shell became a blacksmith and worked at the trade when he returned to the reservation. All his life, he treasured the medicine bag. When he was old and I was a man, he gave it to me. Grandpa quit talking, and I stared in disbelief as he covered his face with his hands. His shoulders shook with quiet sobs. I looked away until he began to speak again. I kept the bag until my son, your mother's father, was a man and had to leave us to fight in the war across the ocean. I gave him the bag for I believed it would protect him in battle, but he did not take it with him. He was afraid he would lose it. He died in a faraway land. Again, Grandpa was still, and I felt his grief around me. My son, he went on after clearing his throat, had no sons, only one daughter, your mother. So the medicine bag must be passed to you. He unbuttoned his shirt, pulled out the leather pouch, and lifted it over his head. He held it in his hand, turning it over and over as if memorizing how it looked. In the bag, he said as he opened it and removed two objects, is the broken shell of the iron kettle, a pebble from the butte, and a piece of the sacred sage. He held the pouch upside down, and fine dust drifted out. After the bag is yours, you must put a piece of prairie sage within and never open it again until you pass it on to your son. He replaced the pebble and the piece of iron and tied the bag. I stood up, somehow knowing I should. Grandpa slowly rose from the bed and stood upright in front of me, holding the bag before my face. I closed my eyes and waited for him to slip it over my head. But he spoke. No, you need not wear it. He placed the soft leather bag in my right hand and closed my other hand over it. It would not be right to wear it in this time and place where no one will understand. Put it safely away until you are again on the reservation. Wear it then, when you replace the sacred sage. Grandpa turned and sat again on the bed. Wearily, he leaned his head against the pillow. Go, he said. I will sleep now. Thank you, Grandpa, I said softly, and left with the bag in my hands. That night, Mom and Dad took Grandpa to the hospital. 2 weeks later, I stood alone on the lonely prairie of the reservation and put the sacred sage in my medicine bag.
All right. Sorry if you heard my dogs walking around during that. What you're going to do next is you are going to go back to today's assignment, and there is a comprehension check activity for you to do on a Google Doc. And if you get that done, please be sure to get out your independent reading books and read.